Hello and welcome. I hope you're doing well. It's your friendly narrator Sue here, and I just like to say, when I was younger, my favorite times would be when my family would gather together. I would go and play with my cousins while the adults sat and talked. But once it started getting dark out, something magical happened. We lit candles and everybody came together. The children, the adults, the elders, and we began to share, in that candlelight, our stories. Stories of the paranormal, scary things that had happened to us, family lore, encounters with monsters, all sorts of spooky things, and these were my favorite times as a kid. So, allow me to light the candles and invite you, wherever you may be, into my living room. For the next hour, your family. So please, sit, listen, enjoy. Grab a snack, grab a drink, get cozy. As I share with you some terrifying stories, some heartwarming encounters, but most of all, every tale I tell is thought-provoking. Here we indulge in tales of Bigfoot, dogman, and a whole host of other paranormal entities. So, get cozy, cuz here we go. My name is Kathy, and I live in a small rural town in Indiana called Osceola. One day, I was feeding my chickens in their pen when I heard a noise coming from the barn. I went to investigate and saw a strange shadow-like creature near the doorway. It was a bit larger than a man, and had long arms and shorter legs. Its hair was dark and matted, and its eyes were black. I was terrified, but I also couldn't help but be curious. I slowly backed away from the creature, and it turned and leapt into the forest. I couldn't believe how much ground it covered in just a few steps. I told my husband what I had seen, but he was, of course, skeptical. He insisted it must have been an overgrown coyote, which ticked me off. I called my local friend, Sarah, who informed me of her cousins who had seen wood apes in Indiana for years. That is when I learned wood ape is another term for Bigfoot, and that more than one of the creature roams our country. That bit of information confirmed what I had seen. A few weeks after I saw the creature in the barn, my husband and I were walking in our woods when we heard an odd noise. I stopped to listen carefully and spotted the silhouette in a nearby clearing. It was the same shadow-like figure. It was standing on its hind legs and eating what appeared to be a rabbit. That was when I observed its blocky yellow teeth. The creature saw us and didn't seem to mind us at first glance, but after a few seconds, it stopped eating. It stared for a moment, then ducked into the field. Stunned by what he had just seen, my husband grabbed my hand and backed away. "It might be flanking us," he whispered. "We need to get out of here." Fortunately, we made it home unharmed. We've never seen the creature again. I feel it traveled elsewhere. I've heard other stories about wood apes, and I believe them. The descriptions match what I had seen. I'll always wonder if many wood apes reside in the forest of Indiana, but they're superb hiders. On to the next one. Some people have told me what I experienced was nothing more than a vision or dream, but I have, or should say, had evidence. This story is not just odd, but makes me question reality itself, so here goes. It was a dark and foggy summer night, one you'd expect if you live in southern Louisiana. I was 19 at the time, and heading back for my girlfriend's house. It was not quite midnight, and I was exhausted. I had been up since very early that morning, had worked all day, and then spent most of the evening helping her paint her house. I had to get up early, and if it hadn't been for my failure of mind to bring a change of clothes, I would have spent the night and spared myself the terror of what was about to happen. I was traversing through an S-curve in the road at a speed that wasn't safe, but I was young and stupid. When my headlights broke through a dense part of the fog, there in front of me was a creature. It stood on 2 feet, was brown, and by my recollection, stood about 6 to 7 feet tall. I swear to this day, it looked at me and we both shared a glance. What was off-putting was it had a human-like face. Its head was covered in thick brown hair or fur, but its face wasn't. It had a heavy, thick brow, large lips, a big flat nose, and its large, round eyes were sunken in. I instinctually swerved to miss it, went off the road, swung the wheel hard to the left, went back on the road, then the right wheels of my Jeep CJ7 seemed to catch something, and the next thing I know, I'm rolling. All I remember is my seatbelt malfunctioned, and I was thrown clear of the Jeep, landing on the road. The next part is where things get weird, so bear with me. I was unconscious for how long, I don't know. I recall coming to briefly. I lifted my head, looked and saw the Jeep some 50 feet away, its headlights still on and illuminating the road, allowing me to see the debris and glass which littered the road. My body was racked with pain. I tried to move, but couldn't, so I laid my head back down. I heard footfalls behind me. I called out for help, and they stopped. I kept asking for whoever was there to help me. Nothing happened. I could then hear a car coming, and by the sound of it, they were traveling at a high rate of speed. I began to get scared. They'd not see me in time and run me over. I started to beg for whoever I heard to help me. I pleaded and cried out. The car drew closer and my fear rose. I continued to beg and I tried to move, but I had what I would find out later had broken my hip and left leg. I didn't know what to do. I suddenly heard the footfalls. They were heavy and close. Without a comment or noise, someone grabbed my arms and dragged me off the road and into the brush along the side of the road. I looked, and it was the creature. Yes, I know what you're thinking, but it had come back or maybe never left and had pulled me to safety. Like before, we shared a quick glance before it raced off into the woods. The car, which had been headed in my direction, slammed on its brakes and came to a stop 20 feet past where I'd been lying in the road. I would have been run over and possibly killed. The rest of the story isn't eventful. An ambulance eventually came and I healed after much PT work. What I know is that the creature saved my life that night. It had pulled me to safety and I'm grateful. I've gone back to the spot often to see if I can see it again, but I never have. I know many people are afraid of Bigfoot or whatever they are, but I'm not. And one day I hope to see it again, so I can look at it once more and thank it for saving my life. On to the next one. In Carter County in Tennessee. When I was about 15, three of my friends and I were camping in the woods above my house. We had 2 dogs, a collie and a female husky. We had built a lean-to to sleep under. We were just talking about things, girls and such, when one of my friends let us know that he heard something.
and we just laughed at him. About 2 or 3 minutes later, two of my friends claimed to have heard the same noise, so the two of us that did not hear it started to make fun of them. About 5 minutes after that, our dog started pacing back and forth and acting strange. Then, all at once, a loud yell came from behind the lean-to, and it shook hard. I could see it visibly shaking. We all ran, except for one, and he froze and could not move. We ran through the pitch-black woods, hitting trees and running through briars. When we got out of the woods, we turned and noticed that our friend was not with us. We yelled for him, and about 2 minutes later, he came out of the woods carrying his collie in his arms. I never knew what this thing was, but my friend said he could not see it, and he could hear it behind him making a grunting sound as he sat in front of the fire. He could hear it behind him walking as he walked out of the woods some distance behind him. We went back the next day with an adult to retrieve our sleeping bags and things, and our lean-to had been torn down. The rocks we had for the fire pit were scattered. The whole area smelled 10 times worse than a wet dog. When this thing yelled from behind our lean-to, it was super loud, as if someone had loudspeakers behind our lean-to. There was a loud scream and shaking of our structure during the incident and a wet dog smell around our campsite, as well as our structure torn down after the incident. It was dry with no wind that I can remember, a little chilly. It was on a ridge in the woods that would overlook the Long Hollow Road and some cow pastures. A couple of weeks later, we were in a field about 1 mile away where this happened, and we heard a huge tree fall, and afterward, the same loud scream about 200 yards from us, up in the woods above the field, and never anything else after or since. On to the next one. We have lived nearby the Oregon coastal town of Yachat for a little over a year now, and we began reading Sasquatch encounters since we first arrived here. Moving to this oceanside community was not in our plans, as we were perfectly happy in our home in Baker City, Oregon, on the far eastern side of the state, until my husband's uncle passed away and Jim was the sole heir to his property. Being retired for a year already, we had my brother watch over our property in Baker, and we came here to Yachat to sell the estate, which we figured would be only a matter of a month or so, and then we planned to return home to Baker City. We soon found out that selling property on the dank and damp ocean side in the winter is like selling a field of freshly planted potatoes in anticipation of a super good crop to come later. You can tell people that show up to see the home all about the beautiful summers, but it's like trying to paint a masterpiece on a sheet of brown paper. To quote my husband, that dog don't hunt. So, we had made the decision to move into the house and wait out the dismally gray and coastal winter. There was little sense in just sitting inside, so we bought some waterproof gear and began hiking the thick forests of the Pacific coast. We were surprised at how many really beautiful days there were among the rainy spells, and once we began to feel comfortable, we ventured even further into the thicker forest, where there was an abundance of wildlife. Then we met Bigfoot, although we were already pretty much convinced that this mystery animal really did exist, as the locals had sworn to it. It took an actual face-to-face meeting for us to truly believe. The Sasquatch was also said to be all over the area back home, but we had never seen one. This chance meeting was when we were following a pine needle carpeted wide trail among the jungle of enormous pine trees that wound circuitously through the enormous amount of fallen giant that had been uprooted years before by a huge storm that hit on one Columbus Day holiday that people from here to Portland still talk about. Winds of 100 plus miles an hour had virtually devastated many pristine forests that were already growing when Christopher Columbus first set foot on American soil. The cost of removal of the timber in this rugged area was, according to the locals, too great, so they left these magnificent monoliths to rot. After all of these years, the majority of these giants seemed to be solid. There were a lot of animal trails through this maze of monsters, and it took a few dead ends where the trees were on top of each other until we learned to follow the animal trails around and through where the forest dwellers had already found the easiest way to navigate the maze. On the other side of this forest area that seemed to have borne the brunt of the main destruction was a place like a giant meteor hole or something, because it was over 150 feet across and almost perfectly round, as though a gigantic rock had landed there and then bounced away. We didn't bother with the cause, as this hole was perfect for our hobby, target shooting with handguns. After first discovering this perfect spot, we began coming here often, as we soon found out that a lesser-known truth about the Oregon coast is that, contrary to the common beliefs of visitors, it does not rain all the time, only a lot of the time. Oregon weather seems designed to keep the population low. The nice thing about being retired here is that we could take advantage of the nice days and stay home on the rainy ones. You might say it's like being able to choose your own weekend. When the sun was out, so were we. We'd buckle on our handguns, take a lunch, throw on our backpacks, and head up to our private recreation area. The place we did our shooting was just over a big forested ridge, so it was unlikely that anyone in the residential area could have ever even heard a gunshot. One day after defeating our paper target foe, we were seated further down the hill from our target range and enjoying the sound of a small mountain stream. Yes, we always wear hearing protection, but the sound of the gently falling creek seemed louder than it had before, since we had not been this far down the slope and had never given any thought to where the creek went after passing us. We decided to explore further, since we seemed to be the only humans who ever came here. There had been some heavy rains and a dusting of snow afterward that we figured was causing the increased sound of splashing water. But as we descended further down the well-used animal trail, we heard a strange sound that reminded us of the snorting of the horses that we had recently ridden at the local ranch. That sort of a blow the horse makes as it lets off excess air when coming to a sudden stop. We hadn't even thought of there being any other trails or routes into this area, so we were whispering back and forth what we each thought we heard, when suddenly Jim's hand went straight up to signal a halt, and following his lead, I too knelt on the thick carpet of pine needles, and we peered at the stunning beauty of the sunlit mountain pond. Before and downhill from us, there was a sight I thought I would never see. There was a dark brown animal that at first I thought was a bear, standing on its hind legs. But as it sniffed the air and slowly turned, it suddenly stopped dead still and stared directly at where we knelt. And even though neither of us had seen anything other than an artist's rendering, I knew it was a Sasquatch. As neither of us dared move, my breath coming in slight gasps that to me were certainly loud, the animal made a glance to its left side and waved its gigantic paw as one would to shoo away a pet. And then I saw another Sasquatch, only a much lighter brown and quite a bit shorter. The smaller animal carefully began sidestepping and then turned directly away and carefully proceeded to make its way along the tumbling creek until it was hidden from our view. Only then did the larger animal make a slight turn, and before it too began leaving, follow its mate, it looked more closely at us, as if trying to see if we were a danger, and then with a loud snort that seemed to be out of disgust at not knowing what we were, It bolted into the dark wood and was gone from sight in seconds. Neither of us spoke. At first, we listened to the retreating sounds of the Sasquatch, seemingly smashing the forest in frustration. We sat down on the ground in a state of awe at these beautiful creatures that heretofore we had assumed to be only a tourist attraction, as no one we had ever met claimed to have seen one. We found out much later that most of the residents had, but they kept quiet so more strangers wouldn't begin flooding into their peaceful community. This experience changed our regimen entirely. We no longer did any target shooting at our favorite place, but we still continued our hike. Only now we carried our larger caliber handguns as we were curious about the Sasquatch, but ever mindful of the fact that it's still a wild animal, a huge wild animal. And although we would never consider harming one of these creatures, the noise of a larger caliber handgun should be a deterrent to most any animal. Some friends jokingly said they carry guns as protection from Californians. After such an experience, we shared our excitement with a couple of our newly made friends, being careful not to give away the place where the encounter happened. But it turned out that a couple of people who we told had also seen the creatures, but had not spoken of their events as they feared we might think they were fooling with us. Once they heard of our sighting, we learned that they were brimming with a desire to share their own tales, which they gladly did. We soon found out that a large number of locals had similar stories that they were reticent about. After we suddenly became one of the group, the attitude of standoffishness to newcomers rapidly evaporated, and we suddenly had a feeling of belonging, as though we had been born and raised here. It really seemed to be more of a home to us than where we had our route clear across the state. Maybe because back in Baker, we all had ranches a ways apart from one another. We continued our weekly trek into the dense forest of Sasquatch territory, and with suggestions from many of our new friends, we began a regimen of bringing gifts of food to our furry friends. Food items that people had found from experience that Sasquatch seemed to really enjoy. And then the winter snows decided to dump tons of that cold, white blanket all over the mountain. In the town of Ichat, the snow only lasted on the ground long enough to let us make a few passes with brooms, but the Sasquatch mountain retreat on the hills behind and around us were totally covered enough to remind us of being back in Baker City. The whole town of Ichat stayed white for a while, as the town didn't even own a snowplow. The state had plowed Highway 101 as it went from Canada to Mexico, and even though it was a two-lane road, to us it was our freeway. Coming from a place where winters came to stay until spring, we were pleasantly surprised when it began to warm up, and combined with the slight but enduring light rain, after all it is the Oregon coast, the snows up and down the coast became only a memory. Up above the town, however, was a different story. From the town, looking up at the white forest and slope, we automatically assumed we were stalked up until spring. We made the assumption that the Sasquatch had retired to their dens or cave or whatever they and the bear population normally did back in eastern Oregon. We were shocked to find out differently and grudgingly accepted the invitation of a couple of our new friends to accompany them up on a road that led over to the other side of that mountain. On our jaunt, the day was sunny, and the now seemingly warm ocean winds made the weather almost tolerable. We soon reached a place where the snowplows had cleared a wide area alongside the highway to allow plenty of room for the trucks crossing the mountain to put on or remove their tire chains. Parking at the far end of the lot, our friends led us up into the thickly forested area that began at the very edge atop the cliff bordering where we parked. The climb was strenuous, but after we reached the thick trees, it seemed as though the snow had failed to break through. The thick canopy of pine boughs that covered the entire forest like a blanket. The sun was fast melting the snow, and as it melted, it appeared that the water was running down the branches and then down the trunks of the trees so that walking beneath them was easy, as there was almost no snow on the forest floor, and the runoff down the tree trunks made it feel almost like a chilly summer day. We couldn't believe that it would be so peaceful and quiet under the dark green canopy, and in places where there was an opening for the sun to shine through, there was a layer of steam rising in the air with the pleasant smell of pine, avoiding the occasional mound of accumulated snow that found its way through the floor. There were wisps of steam rising as the sun's rays worked at melting it away. The silence of the forest was hardly disturbed by the faint sound of vehicles, and soon the only sound one would hear was the occasional thump of a pine cone as it fell to the carpeted forest floor. Even the sound of the light wind seemed to disappear as our friends led us down a long, sloping trail that exited the ridgeline that we had been following, and after a few more twists and turns, we suddenly came to a stop. As our guide's hand raised above his head and turned toward us, he held up his forefinger to his lips as a signal to be still. We were both alarmed and excited at the same time. Not even daring to do more than lightly breathe, we stood completely still while Ray, our host, took the goodie bags we carried the whole time since we had parked. He had handed each of us a gunny sack, which we accepted without question, as if we knew what they contained. We had correctly assumed from the previous conversations where we were aware that these folks had been feeding the Sasquatch. No explanation was necessary. Being one who likes constant chatter as we hike, I noticed that Jim was heeding the rules of squatching that our friends refer to when our first discussion of the Sasquatch came about. As the three of us stood silently by, our guide carefully and slowly walked down and around the huge boulder that stood as a silent sentry to guard the narrow trail he had taken. And as we stood without moving more than was necessary, after only a few minutes, our guide returned, minus the four gunny sacks of treats for the Sasquatch. We carefully and quietly returned the way we had come, and it wasn't until we reached the place where we had first encountered the forest that anyone spoke a word. It was easy to understand the silence we had maintained, and our host explained that we were the first guests they had ever brought here, so they felt it was best that we make the trip in silence, so as not to intimidate their Bigfoot friends, which were fully concurred with having recently experienced our own encounter and reacting the same way. The absolute excitement makes one feel protective of these awesome creatures. During the entire winter, we made only three more visits to that area, the last trip being one where the guys had to fight their way through very deep snow in the forest. We ladies stayed at the parking area while the two goofy men brought the offering to the Sasquatch. Jim was really surprised to see that when they arrived with the groceries, that a giant of a Sasquatch came out of the darkness of the forest to take the bags before they were even out of sight. Jim said they had turned to leave when a sort of whistle stopped them, and they turned to see a huge gorilla-looking animal wave, and it again whistled as they in turn waved back to him. That emotional experience almost made Jim teary-eyed as he relayed that moment. We were so pleased to share the excitement and knowledge of these Sasquatches, and we learned further from our friends that they suspected that the Sasquatch had a period of hibernation, but their opinions were mixed. On one hand, they were never able to make the trek much after mid-January, as they said that even the parking areas that we had used were not plowed on any kind of a regular basis after late January, and the snows were usually so deep at that time of year, a person could not likely make the trek through the deep snow to that rendezvous rock anyway. Our friends did not normally visit with more friendship offerings for the Sasquatch until April, so they could not definitely say whether the animals hibernated or not, but their consensus of opinion was they believed that rather than hibernate, the Sasquatches made their way back down to the lower altitudes. But they couldn't be sure because the few dirt roads into the lower forests at that time of year were mostly mud. That was why they left their offerings at the higher altitude. Well, our exciting experiences and the much shorter winters had their effect on us. So that next spring, we sold the home in Baker, Oregon, and sunk our roots permanently in Sasquatch country, where we are currently making our list of preferred Sasquatch cuisine thanks to our friends. We plan to give them a full tour of our own Sasquatch area, as it is much easier to get into since it's not too far from our back door and a heck of a lot more fun to visit. On to the next one. I'm Rick, and I spent over 40 years of my life as a hunting guide in Alaska. I was born and raised in Fairbanks, but I retired in Colorado to be near my kids, who all left Alaska and never went back, other than to visit. Seems like they didn't care for the endless winter nights back home. After my parents had passed away, I left Fairbanks and moved down to Soldotna on the Kenai. Guiding out of there, I liked Fairbanks, but most of my clients wanted to hunt the big coastal brown bears, and the Kenai was closer to the places I guided, which included Kodiak Island. Well, when this event I'm about to relate happened, things were slow, or I never would have taken these guys out. It was during the recession, and I was feeling kind of desperate, but I have only myself to blame, as I had a bad hunch from the start and ignored it. If I'd known then what I knew at the end of this trip, I would have never in a million years agreed to guide them. Anyway, here I was with two greenhorns from, well, you would expect to hear they were from Chicago or some big city, but no, these guys were from Idaho. I think that's partly why I didn't listen to my gut. How bad can two guys from Idaho be? I mean, there are lots of bears there and lots of hunting. Why they didn't just stay home and hunt is beyond me. Well, actually, I do know. They wanted to brag about hunting the big Kodiaks in Alaska. I'll tell you, some of my best clients have been from big cities. These guys are aware that they don't know much and will listen to you. They respect your knowledge and expertise. They're easy to guide and are really happy to be in Alaska. Whether they get a bear or not, they value the experience. These two Idaho guys were the opposite. At one point, I asked them why they'd even bother to hire me, since they already knew it all. They just laughed. We all knew they had hired me because if you're not an Alaskan, you can't hunt for Kodiak bears unless you have a licensed Alaskan guide along. Okay, we were going to Kodiak. It's no minor task to hunt in Kodiak, and the number of licenses there are very restricted. Kodiak bears are in limited supply, and Alaska game and fish won't let them be overhunted. It's considered a unique privilege to hunt them, and it's not cheap. I don't remember exactly what I charged these guys, but it was a lot. I have friends up there who still guide, and they tell me it typically costs over $20,000 per person to be guided on Kodiak Island. That doesn't include a bunch of other fees, like licenses and hiring a float plane. You have to have a float plane to get you and your gear to Kodiak, and they charge by the pound. If you're a big guy with lots of gear, you'll pay more. Usually, it's around $500 for an hour, £4,000, including you. If you decide to go in by boat, you're looking at about the same price per person per day. It's not cheap. On top of all of that, the hunting season only lasts for about 6 weeks in the spring and fall. And once you pull your license and are on the ground, you have only 2 weeks to get your bear. Then you have to come out regardless. Well, we went in the fall, late October, primarily because these guys wanted the big, full coat the bears have then. The main problem with fall hunting is that the days are shorter and the bears start denning up. But one good thing is that the mosquitoes are pretty much gone. There are a ton of rules when hunting Kodiak brownies, and as the guide, you'd better know them all, which I did. One such rule was no night hunting or using night vision scope. There are a number of methods employed to hunt bears, one being to hoof it to a likely spot, then set up a windbreak or shelter, hiding and scoping for movement, kind of letting the bear come to you. The Kodiak grizzly is the largest carnivore in North America, and they're generally easy to spot. They can be up to 10 feet tall and weigh 1,500 pounds. When you're on ground like that, you have to always be aware of the wind direction and move into it so the bear won't smell you. One problem with sitting and waiting for a bear to come to you is that the wind will change, advertising your location to every critter out there. My hunts had a really high success rate, and the reason was that I moved my hunters around instead of waiting for the bears, which meant we could change directions when the winds did. How did I do this? By zodiac raft. In the fall, we floated the rivers and bogs and almost always came upon bears eating late-spawning salmon or berries. We moved fast enough that they usually didn't have the opportunity to smell us. So, these two yahoos arrived in the Anchorage airport, where my wife picked them up. When I saw them, they looked like two rats just fresh off a barge after a long trip at sea. I kind of felt sorry for them, as they'd said they'd both gotten airsick on the way. This worried me, as we still had to fly to Kodiak. If you can get airsick in a big jet, there wasn't much hope in a small plane. At least it would be a relatively short trip, I thought. I took them down to the Alaska Department of Fish and Game to get their licenses. This set the clock to ticking on the two-week window, so I hoped to get to Kodiak that same day. I'd already hired a float plane to get us and our gear there. We drove back out to the airport, where I left them in the care of my wife, who was plying them with hot coffee and cinnamon rolls. With the help of the pilot, a friend of mine, I loaded our gear onto the float plane, including the Zodiac inflatable raft. I then jumped in, and in a couple of hours, we were flying low over one of Kodiak Island's many small bays. The island is mountainous and heavily forested in the northeast, where I guided, with many deep bays that provide good anchorages for boats. We landed and unloaded the gear, dragging it up onto the beach. My plan was that I would stay with the gear. When I had just one client, I would usually fly back with the pilot, making sure the gear had plenty of red flagging on it, so we could find it again. But with two clients, it was better to stay and not overload the plane. I always planned for the worst, and assumed it would take the full 2 weeks to get the bear. Besides the Zodiac, I had plenty of free dried food, which I liked because it was portable and didn't smell until opened. I also had a stove, water and filter, sleeping bags, and a couple of good canvas tents that would withstand the heavy winds so well known on the island. I even had a couple of smaller lightweight nylon tents in case we decided to leave our base camp and make a spike camp, which I would only do if we were having no luck hunting from the raft. All this, along with other survival gear and a small engine for running upstream made for a heavy load. Our gear also included three 338 mag rifles with waterproof rifle stocks and plenty of ammo, as well as 6 cans of bear spray. The cans almost seemed like an afterthought next to all the other gear, but the bear spray had saved my life before, and I considered it to be the most important thing in all that gear. You're not supposed to have it in planes with pressurized cabins, but a float plane was okay. As I watched the pilot leaving, skimming across the water, I suddenly felt a sense of isolation that was almost overpowering. I'd felt it before, but this particular time, it seemed much stronger than usual. It was so disturbing that it made me start thinking about retiring, which I actually did shortly afterwards. I don't know. Maybe what my pilot friend had told me on the flight over had an effect. He'd said the Kodiak bears had been especially aggressive that summer, and several had even come into a couple of the native towns and torn things up, as well as destroying a few hunting camps. The natives were saying that the bears were angry at all the people coming in and disturbing their home. A couple of bear-viewing businesses had started up that year. I assumed that's what they were talking about. I hadn't guided a Kodiak hunt since the spring, so it was all news to me. Well, I'm not sure what time it was, but it had to be around 2 p.m. when the pilot left. I expected the two Idaho guys to arrive in about 4 hours, which gave me plenty of time. Even though it was now fall, the days were still long enough to do what needed to be done. I would set up the tent on the beach, gather some wood, then, when they arrived, make some dinner. We could sit around the campfire for a couple of hours, then fall into our sleeping bags. I suspected they would be really tired. I normally would set to it and get everything sorted, pitch the tent, and make sure everything was ready before kicking back and waiting. But for some reason, I felt like sitting there on a log for a while. I felt a sense of uncertainty, not at all my normal feeling of competence. As I sat there, I thought about all the years I'd been doing this. I'd always liked Kodiak Island. There was something really special about its big trees and the vast solitude they encompassed, as well as the blue inlets and fjords. It evoked a feeling that I imagined was similar to what the first people to cross the Bering Strait felt when they viewed Alaska. It felt rugged and raw and untouched, like the ends of the earth. I watched as another float plane flew overhead, probably taking in another guide and his client. I normally wouldn't like to see anyone, but the plane felt comforting for some reason. A touch of civilization, I guess. I finally got up and started gathering wood, making a big pile near where I then pitched the two tents, my tent, a ways away from the other. I had too many clients who snored to want to sleep close together, bears or no bears. I then organized the gear, pulling a big tarp across everything, and tying it securely to some shrubs in case winds came in during the night. Kodiak Island sits on the northwest corner of the Gulf of Alaska, which is a breeding ground for big storms. High winds and harsh weather are common, and I always carried a shortwave radio to check the weather report. Everything was ready. I sat back down on a log, watching the small waves lapping against the beach. It was almost hypnotic, and I realized I was tired. I had no idea what time it was, but I knew it was getting late. Where was the float plane? I was beginning to worry. Finally, it was dark enough that I knew the plane couldn't come in, and I knew something must be wrong. It wouldn't be the first time I'd had clients arrive late, usually because of bad weather or some kind of mechanical problem. In a way, I was kind of glad, as long as nothing serious was wrong, as it gave me a night to myself. I'd taken up guiding because I love the outdoors, but it seemed like I was usually too busy with all the things that go with guiding to ever really enjoy being out. I was tired, but something was making me uncomfortable enough that I decided to build a fire. When I'm out alone, I rarely build fires, as they announce to everyone where I am, and I prefer to be in stealth mode when out by myself. But that night, a fire seemed like the nicest thing in the world. So, I built a big one, almost a bonfire. I sat close to it, the warmth feeling good, both physically and mentally. After eating a freeze-dried beef stroganoff dinner, I sat there for what seemed like hours, watching the wood slowly burn itself into red, twinkling coals. Finally, too tired to stay up, I poured water on the coals and crawled into my tent. I was soon fast asleep. For someone who had just been feeling uncomfortable about his surroundings, I sure slept hard. It seemed like it must be dawn when I finally woke up and thought I could hear someone whistling. Had the float plane come in? I poked my head out of the tent fly and realized it was still too dark for a plane to land. I could barely see the first hint of daylight through the trees behind me. I crawled back into my bag, not wanting to deal with the chill. The fall season in Kodiak is October 25th to November 30th, and that time of year, it gets downright cold, with temperatures falling as low as 0 degrees. It felt like it was below freezing. As I crunched down into my bag, I heard it again. Someone was whistling. It had an eerie quality to it. Maybe it was the people in the other plane I'd seen yesterday. As I listened, I realized the eerie quality came from a hollowness. The whistle was low and hollow and very loud. It had to be some kind of instrument. And I then figured some of the Kodiak natives were around. Maybe someone from Larson Bay was out on a boat. It was an incredible sunrise, and soon I heard the distant whine of an airplane coming in, and the float plane soon landed. One of the guys had gotten seriously airsick when they tried to fly out the previous day, and the pilot had turned back, thus the delay. The two fellows from Idaho were quickly on the beach, taking photos as the plane turned and floated back out on the bay, and took off. I don't know why I didn't listen to my gut, because it was telling me. No, it wasn't telling me. It was shouting at me, saying, go on out with the plane, cancel the trip, and leave. Of course, it seemed foolish to even consider that, given the cost of the float plane and the fact we'd have to haul all the gear out, not to mention I'd have to reimburse all those big bucks to my client. I guess I could have said I was sick or something, but I'm not that kind of guy. Once I make a commitment, I honor it. We spent the morning sighting in our guns, with me making sure they knew the basics. I had them practice shooting from several positions, as I wanted to know their capabilities, as well as making sure they understood the ballistics of their rifles, as these were not their own personal guns. Of course, we made lots of noise, and I was sure the natives I'd heard whistling earlier were long gone. We finally had some lunch, then inflated the Zodiac with my little portable compressor and got it all set up with the outboard motor and some supplies and survival gear. We would cruise around the area some while I taught them what they needed to know to hunt Kodiaks in Alaska, then come back to our base camp for the night. I didn't expect to get very far, but it was important to orient them to the area and make sure they knew the basic safety requirements for hunting grizzlies, such as how to use bear spray. As we floated out into the bay, I glanced back at our camp. I swore I saw someone there, but when I looked again, they were gone. This didn't sit well with me, and I wondered if someone was going to steal my gear, which was basically unheard of on Kodiak Island. I motored up a ways into a small inlet that turned into a river, all the while telling the guys about bears and what to expect, while they used binoculars to scan the countryside. I didn't really expect to see much, since we were making so much noise, but this was just a recon trip anyways. I finally pulled over on the shore, where we got out and climbed a small hill, then sat motionless with spotting scopes, scanning the places where brown bears were likely to be seen, such as south-facing hillsides and openings in thick, brushy areas. So far, the two guys had been congenial and thoughtful, so I had no idea what was to come. As we sat there watching for suspicious-looking dark spots or odd-shaped bushes or logs, I thought I saw movement in the periphery of my vision. Turning, I was certain something had quickly slipped behind a distant tree, as if it had seen me looking towards it. From nowhere, the feeling I had the previous night hit me. I felt very strange. I almost felt as if I were being stalked. And yet, I had no evidence of such, just a couple of unusual things. For the thought to even cross my mind was odd. As I'm not paranoid, especially when carrying a 338 mag rifle. It was getting on toward evening, so we gathered everything up and went back down to the Zodiac, where we took off and were soon back at base camp. The day had gone well, and my two clients seemed happy, especially after dinner. My wife had sent in some big, thick steaks for our first dinner out, and I baked some potatoes in the coals to go with them. Afterward, we all sat around the fire, the guys listening while I told them bear stories. Some of the stories were kind of hairy, and I even told a few tales of guys getting killed, though it was a relatively rare occurrence and hadn't happened to any of my clients. I later wondered what had gotten into me, as I typically would never do something like that, worrying I might taint the trip. Guides can get some pretty big tips if the client has a good trip, so I never wanted to do anything worrisome. Besides, if they heard weird noises in the night, I would be the one to suffer, as they'd be in my tent wanting me to take care of things. Well, as luck would have it, they did come to my tent in the middle of the night, waking me and wanting to know why I'd been throwing rocks at them. I was irritated that they would wake me up for such nonsense, as I knew they were making it all up. I got my big spotlight out and shined it around their tent, and sure enough, there were several big rocks nearby, and one that hit the tent square on, ripping a small hole. They finally convinced me they were telling the truth, primarily because I could tell they were scared to death. I made up a story about how the natives would sometimes do that to try to scare people off, though I'd never heard of such a thing. But that seemed to placate them, if not make them somewhat angry. Truth be told, I had no idea who would be throwing rocks in the middle of the night, way out here in the middle of nowhere. It was strange. We all finally went back to bed. Well, at least I did, and I found out later they stayed up the rest of the night, watching with their night vision scopes and drinking. Since guns and alcohol don't mix, I don't allow drinking on my expeditions, and I make that clear up front. So when I got up the next morning and found them passed out with a couple of whiskey bottles nearby, I wasn't a happy camper, to say the least. But given the strangeness of the previous night, I decided I would overlook it this time. Since early morning is the best time to hunt, I woke them, in spite of their protests. While they drank coffee, I got things organized and ready for the day. By then, I was ready to get a bear, so I could get out of there. I was mad that they'd been drinking, and the odd things that were going on were starting to make me skittish. Since most brown bears begin entering dens by early November, I was hoping we could get into an area where a bear was denning and catch it unawares. Bears will generally choose steep slopes at higher elevations for their den, so I had a nearby area in mind, one where we could motor upstream a few miles, then tie up and hike a couple more miles into an area with some good topography. They were finally ready, and as we got into the Zodiac, something in the mud on the beach caught my eye. It was a set of two tracks, unlike anything I'd ever seen, kind of like one a barefoot person would leave if standing in one spot, but much larger. The tracks sank into the mud several inches and were washed out looking. What puzzled me was that they were the only tracks on the beach other than ours. How could someone leave just one set of tracks? It then dawned on me that it was possible only if they'd been swimming and stopped long enough to stand up in the shallow water as the tide was going out. My two clients didn't see the tracks, and I wasn't about to point them out. No reason to add any more fuel to what had already gone on. I decided that someone had boated up to our camp while we were gone and got out for a minute, and their tracks were large because the water had distorted them. I started the motor and was ready to take off when something occurred to me. What if whoever was messing around with us came into our camp while we were gone? I stepped back out of the raft and went back to the tent, grabbing a dry bag and putting some freeze-dried food into it, as well as our water filter and a few other items, including the lightweight tents, a solar lantern, and my portable one-burner Coleman stove. We now had enough survival gear with us that we could make it for a while if need be. "Why are we taking this stuff?" one of the guys asked. "Just in case," I replied, which really didn't answer his question. But he didn't question it. Both guys were acting pretty subdued, as if they were feeling under the weather. It was another uneventful day, and we didn't even see a bear, let alone shoot one. I was disappointed, as I really wanted to get a bear and go home, but I guess I was going to have to earn my keep on this one. It was late when we floated back to the beach where our base camp sat, and I didn't bother to unload anything from the raft, just tying it up to a nearby rock. After a dinner of freeze-dried spaghetti, the talk turned from the day's activity to my wondering aloud why we hadn't even seen a bear. There were days when no bears were around, but it was unusual to not at least see one in the far distance. And as I thought more about it, I realized we hadn't seen any wildlife at all, not even a moose or a river otter. Come to think of it, we hadn't even seen a bird. I thought about stories I'd read about animals leaving an area prior to an earthquake. Kodiak was definitely in earthquake central. The thing was, we'd been out all day and hadn't seen anything, and from what I'd read, animals exhibited erratic behavior minutes before a quake, not days. I decided it was coincidental and went to bed, leaving the pair to sit by the fire talking. I suspected they would soon be drinking, but I didn't care, as long as they put the fire out when they went to bed. My attitude was getting worse and worse, and I really didn't know why. Things felt black. I had just drifted into a nice, deep sleep when I suddenly awoke to the smell of smoke and what sounded like drunken yelling. Poking my head out of the tent, I could see our campfire was spreading to the edge of the beach, where lots of brush and undergrowth fed into the deep forest. And even though Kodiak Island typically gets lots of rain, this had been a dry season. Things were ready to rock and roll with just one match. I slipped my boots on and jumped from the tent. Just then, I heard gunfire and could see one of the Idaho guys shooting into the forest. Why would anyone shoot blindly into the forest? My first thought was to try to put the fire out. I yelled at the two guys to help me, but they instead ran the opposite direction toward the raft, yelling something about bears. I tried to stomp out the fire, but it had quickly spread and it was soon in the brush, which quickly caught fire with flames crackling and shooting upward. I was amazed at how quickly the fire moved into the trees. There was nothing I could do to stop it. My next thought was to save as much gear as possible. None of it was cheap, especially the tents, and I yelled at the two guys for help, but they disappeared. I was beyond mad, and I guess my anger helped fuel my actions, as I quickly had both tents down, wadded into bundles around the poles with the sleeping bags wrapped around them. It was all too cumbersome to carry very efficiently, but I soon had part of the gear over by the raft. I went back for the rest of it, but it was too late, as the fire had caught the nearby grasses and was soon almost underfoot. It was time to flee, jump into the raft, and get into the water. I started to drag the tents into the raft, but the raft seemed to be missing. Surely, I had overlooked it in the dark, I thought in a panic, shining my headlamp around, but no, it was gone. The rope that I'd used to tie it to a rock was still there, but someone had cut the raft free. I, of course, knew who that someone was. My courageous client. I had begun to suspect they were nothing but trouble, but I was shocked to find they had lacked such integrity that they would leave me standing in front of an oncoming fire. It was unbelievable. But what was more unbelievable was what I saw when I turned. There, no more than 30 feet away, were two shadowy figures coming towards me from the forest. I at first thought they were my Idaho clients and wondered where the raft had gone, but I soon realized they were too large and bulky to be human. My second thought was that the fire had pushed out two really big Kodiak bears who were now coming straight towards me. I knew wildlife was typically not predatory when under these kind of stressors, but there was nothing to keep them from coming after me anyways. I then realized I'd left my gun in the tent, so it had to be all wrapped up in the melee of tents and sleeping bags. I had about 2 seconds to wonder how I could have been so careless and absent-minded, and then the dark shadows rushed right by me and into the water, swimming out to sea, soon gone. Bears are good swimmers and will often swim across rivers and lakes without much of a thought, but I knew these weren't bears. No Kodiak had ever gotten that large. They must have weighed in at close to 2,000 pounds each. Can you even picture how large an animal that weighs that much is? It's mind-boggling. I'd heard rumors of the hairy men on Kodiak for years, but nobody I knew had ever seen one. So I figured it was just that, rumors. But now I knew better. All of a sudden, the whistling, the tracks, the figure I'd seen in camp, and also along the tree line, well, it all made sense now. How could I have been so clueless? The heat from the fire was now so intense that I had no choice but to follow the shadows into the water, and I can't tell you how scary that was. I pulled off my boots and dog paddled out about 50 feet, hoping the current wouldn't pull me out to sea. Luckily, the tide was coming in, so I had more trouble staying out than being pulled away. I treaded water there for I don't know how long, as the fire gradually retreated, having burned itself out along the beach, now burning back into the interior of the forest. I slowly let the tide pull me into the beach, where I lay for a while, exhausted. As I lay there, I could see the figures had also returned. They must have been doing the same thing I did, biding their time waiting out the fire. I badly wanted to get back over to my tent and gun, but the ground was too hot to walk on, except where it was wet. I realized later when it was daylight that everything had burned. All that was left of my rifle was the barrel. My other two guns had also burned, having been left behind by the Idaho guys in their run for safety. The huge two figures stood looking at me, and the strange feeling I'd had earlier returned. I knew I was in the presence of something that could kill me as easily as I could swat a fly. I stood my ground at raging Kodiak bears, but this felt different. It made me feel very humble and small. After what felt like forever, the figures turned and walked away, crossing the still smoldering ground and disappearing into part of the forest the fire hadn't touched. I don't know how long I sat there on the beach, too exhausted to be afraid. Finally, after what seemed like forever, the sun began to rise. I wondered where my two clients were. I can't tell you where I hoped they were, as it would make me look uncharitable. I was lucky, and it wasn't long before a float plane came over and saw me, landing on the water and rescuing me. I won't go into all the details, but the two guys from Idaho ended up on a beach far from the fire, totally lost, where they sat it out for 3 days, waiting for help, scared to death the entire time with no gun. Fortunately for them, they had plenty of survival gear. I guess I was glad I hadn't unloaded the raft, though at that point I was half hoping they'd float on over to Japan or Hawaii or something. They were eventually rescued by the Coast Guard, and after my testimony, their return trip included a visit to the state troopers, where they faced charges for starting the fire, which eventually burned several hundred acres. They were eventually fined thousands of dollars, and last I heard, were also facing a lawsuit from the state. I retired not long after that, but I still lived in Anchorage for a while and would occasionally fly with my pilot friend over Kodiak, just to see what was there. He knew my story and was as eager as I was to find some evidence of the hairy guys, but we never did see any. But then, we never saw any Kodiak bears from the air, either, and we all know they're there. On to the next one. My name is Dylan, and I spent a large portion of my childhood in a small Missouri town called Fredericktown. I lived there from the early 70s until the mid-80s, when, if I remember correctly, the population was just over 2,000. Sure, it was boring at times, but it hosted some of my most fondest memories. By the way, I now live in St. Louis, which has been a completely different type of experience. Even though I had a scary encounter, I sometimes miss the sense of mystery that you often get in those rural towns. I was 9 years old when I went to explore a local creek on a hot summer afternoon. When I was a child, I was passionate about catching amphibians and examining them before releasing them back into the wild. From a young age, my dad taught me that it's good to let them go back into their natural habitat instead of keeping them locked up in a container. I don't think there was ever a single time I kept a critter in captivity, and it was probably partly because I knew I had access to them throughout those summer months. It was incredibly humid on that day of my encounter because there was a major storm the night before. It's interesting how many details you tend to remember when you experience something so shocking. If you think about it hard enough, it's almost as if you can transport yourself back in time and feel certain sensations all over again. I don't remember the creek's name, but you had to walk down a steep decline on both sides to get to it, making it more like a ravine. There were many fallen trees and branches that protruded out into the water, and you would often see rows of turtles lying on the bark while exposed to sunlight. I doubt the water was deeper than 12 inches at any point, aside from right after a storm. Post-storm was always the best time to go to the creek because it was the only time you could fully submerge yourself and swim. The water was probably pretty darn filthy, but you tend to not care about that sort of thing when you're in your youth. And I'm glad I didn't, because those were some of the best times of my life. Whenever the water was deep, it also increased the demand for turtle hangout locations, because so many of them were beneath the surface. That always made it easier to catch them, because it was difficult for them to climb over one another while they were scattered simultaneously. The creek winded at various sections, so you usually wouldn't know if anyone else was around until you walked around a bend into another part, unless someone was really loud by splashing around or whatever. But I was almost always the only one there, and that's probably because the location was a bit treacherous to get to. I think it was because there were no turtles in the stretch that I usually went to that I almost immediately swam around the nearest bend. And that's when I saw them, or it. At first glance, I thought it was an older man with his shirt off. His back was turned to me, and he was standing in the water a few hundred feet ahead. The longer I observed him, the more I realized the guy was incredibly strange looking. What I initially assumed to be a pair of dirty, wet pants was actually hair-covered, extremely muscular legs. The hair seemed to be a combination of dark gray and black, but it's hard to know because it was soaked. Another thing I noticed quickly was how large its hands were, and it was using them to pry something open, and I soon realized that it was a turtle shell. I couldn't see the mouth from where I was, but judging by how its head was moving, I could tell that it was biting into it. Not long after that, it tossed that shell aside and thankfully began moving further away from me rather than toward me. Even the way it walked in the water was bizarre, and I'm not even sure how I should attempt to explain it. I guess the best way to put it would be to say that its joints didn't seem to be constructed like those of a human, causing the muscles to move differently. I so badly wish I had a video camera to record it, because it didn't at all look like what you've seen in the famous Patterson-Gimlin footage from the 1960s. It wasn't much longer before it snatched at something in the water and extracted another turtle. I could hear the sounds of its shell snapping as it was pried open. You could also see fragments of the shell falling into the water before a fresh bite was taken. It continued to move through the water away from me, and I knew it would soon be out of sight. However, I was much too afraid to move a muscle. I felt as though it was already a miracle that it hadn't noticed me when I previously came around the bend. Once about a minute had gone by after it left that area, I turned around, swam to the shore, and ran straight home. It was before I had even made it up the incline that I heard an older woman scream from somewhere in the direction that the animal had gone. It didn't seem like the kind of cry that someone would make if they had been harmed, but I knew they had at least seen the animal and were just as startled as I was. They only screamed once, so I have no way of knowing for sure that whoever it was got away unharmed. I remember how it was while I was on my way home that I realized I must have seen Bigfoot. It all happened back when I was young enough to believe the possibility of there only being one Bigfoot in existence. I'm pretty sure I assumed that it had migrated over to the Midwest from California, but can you blame me? I was at an age where I still believed a plump old man delivered presents to all children via a reindeer-powered sleigh. My teenage brother Devin was the only one around when I arrived home, and I didn't hesitate to tell him all about what had just happened. I could tell that he either thought I was joking or that I had lost my mind. In any case, he wasn't taking the idea of Sasquatch in Missouri very seriously. The following day, I begged Devin to come with me to check out the scene. I wanted to look for broken turtle shells, and I don't think there's any way I would have even considered heading back there myself. When we ended up coming across even more turtle shell fragments than I had expected, I could see by the look on Devin's face that I had gained at least some sense of credibility. He had begun to believe that I had definitely seen something out of the ordinary, but Bigfoot was still a stretch. Since I felt more comfortable being there with another person, we continued to walk along the creek, which had already lost a lot of its depth since the previous day. Since I told Devin about the scream I had heard just before I left the area, we were both curious to see if we could find any sign of someone having been attacked, but as far as either of us could see, there was no trace. Even though Devin never admitted to believing the extent of my claim, I noticed he started checking out Bigfoot books from the nearest library, but for whatever reason, he still didn't seem interested in discussing the topic. It seemed like maybe he was a little embarrassed that he was entertaining the possibility that there was something like that out there. I did bring it up to both of my parents on multiple occasions, but they were always politely dismissive. I had hoped I might have heard something about the woman who screamed only minutes after I saw the animal, but there was nothing. I never even heard a single other rumor about Bigfoot sightings during the time we lived in Fredericktown. I would love to know if any current residents have seen anything or even heard anything they can't explain. I'm not sure why, but something about that would be satisfying to learn. There's no question that the event will always be one of the most prominent highlights of my life. Even all these years later, I'm still amazed that something that strange can be real. It makes me wonder about all the other things that could be out there. What if there is some truth behind nearly every cryptid that people claim to exist? Can you even begin to imagine how skewed our perceptions of reality could be? The possibility that we've been lied to about this stuff is one of the most chilling prospects I can think of. I can only hope that there will come a day where these truths are exposed. On to the next one. Walt Evans was purchasing eggs from a neighbor when something she said startled him. "Did you see the guy in your backyard yesterday?" "No," Evans said. "What did he look like?" The neighbor said he was wearing a furry hat and a furry coat. Evans initially thought maybe someone was trying to steal something from his home. He and his wife had just moved into the area 4 or 5 months previously, and he didn't know the neighbors well yet. He nearly forgot about the whole conversation. Then, the next day, while he was out walking around his property looking for his boundary markers, he found some footprints. There they were. They weren't real big, maybe 13 or 14 inches long, he said, but they were barefoot out in the slushy snow and mud. Who walks around in their bare feet that time of year? Evans realized he was seeing Bigfoot prints. The more he thought about it, he realized the Bigfoot was likely after the neighbor's goat and chickens. Over the next few months, they had a wet spring, and he found more footprints near his home and up in the foothills close to his home. The following year in the spring, he found even more. I find a lot of footprints in the spring, Evan says. There are a lot of them, but one Bigfoot could be making a lot of tracks. It was drier the next year, but I still found some more footprints up there in the junipers. They were much bigger. My foot was dwarfed by it. It must have been 18 or 19 inches long. Each time he finds a footprint, he expects he won't find any more, but then he finds the next set. If you are an observant person, you notice all sorts of things that are out of context, that aren't supposed to be there, he says. That is how he has seen and photographed the Bigfoot, although he admits that most of the pictures are blurry. He said the Bigfoot seemed to sit intensely still for long periods of time and watch people. When he is scanning an area, he notices something doesn't belong, and there he will pull out his scope and obtain a better look. Each time the Bigfoot hasn't seemed aware of him because he has been a long distance away from them. They imitate things, all sorts of inanimate objects like fence poles, stumps, or trees, he says. I will set up a scope on something that looks odd and will take a picture. It appears they are just sitting still for a long time. Then, when I come back, they are gone. Evan said if he wasn't married, he would just sit and watch them all day. He would seriously like to take a picture of them moving, especially one a little closer. I can see them, but they can't see me, he says. They are just doing what they do. I don't think they can sense me when I am that far away. I am waiting for a time when they move when I am watching. He says he has come to the conclusion there are more of them out there than most people realize. He also believes they are migratory. I think they go where the food goes, he says. They follow the deer. Evan said he has spent a lot of time thinking about what he has seen. His knowledge has come after hours of observation of them just doing what they normally do. It's just a shot in the dark, really, he says. I'm just guessing from the tracks I've seen in the spring when there are a lot of them. I think people would be surprised how many there actually are. He said the Bigfoot watch people all the time, and they are smart. So they must realize there are fewer people around at night and choose to use that time to move around. They are smart, and they can sit still for an extraordinarily long time, Evan says. Besides, they have the whole forest to hide in. It's no wonder people don't see them all that often. On to the next one. In 1901, in the Campbell River area on Vancouver Island, in British Columbia, a timber cruiser named Mike King saw a hairy humanoid twice. Mike saw it washing roots by the side of a creek and then stacking them in two piles. Mike found the creature too human to shoot and kill. The creature was large and covered with reddish-brown fur and had long arms and ran off like a man would after becoming aware of his presence and crying out. The creature scooted up a hill, looking back once to check what Mike was doing. Footprints were found, and they showed long, spreading toes. Mike was alone as his First Nation packers refused to accompany him to the area for fear of the monkey men who were in the area. On to the next one. In 1904, several hunters, Mr. J. Kincaid, Mr. T. Hutchins, Mr. A. Crump, and Mr. W. Buss, saw a wild boy near Horn Lake, near Great Central Lake on Vancouver Island in British Columbia and Canada. It was a boy covered with brown hair. The head was long, with long matted hair and a beard but the size of a child. The creature ran off at speed through impenetrable undergrowth. Now, are we seeing the children of the hairy humanoid, or maybe a smaller subgroup of them? On to the next one. During March 1907, captain and crew of the steamship Capilano saw hairy, 5-foot-tall monkey-like creatures that were howling in between intervals of clam digging at Bishop's Cove on Vancouver Island in British Columbia. The local First Nations had sought refuge on the ship when it came close to the shore. They were so frightened of the hairy nocturnal clam diggers, they had abandoned their village. The monkey-like wild man would appear on the beach at night and would howl in an unearthly fashion. On to the next one. A Bigfoot chased Peter Williams home and then pushed against the walls of his wooden house. Mr. Williams lived on the Chehalis Indian Reservation near Harrison River in British Columbia, Canada. On to the next one. At Cougar Lake near Chilliwack in British Columbia, a tall, hairy humanoid that was standing upright was seen. This creature was pulling berry bushes with one hand and putting the berries into its mouth with the other, and was seen by prospectors. On to the next one. At Kakwa, Kiatsu Bay on Swindle Island in British Columbia, Tom Brown saw Bigfoot in the shallows at night. The creature screamed when it was shot at, but no body was found the next day. On to the next one. At Pitt Lake in British Columbia, a hairy humanoid was seen feeding on berries. The creature had a human-like face on a fur-clad body and was watched for a while before it strode off. The creature was watched through binoculars and was definitely not a bear. The tracks were later investigated and were definitely not ursine or bear-like at all. On to the next one. Mr. Frank Dan, who lived on the Chehalis Indian Reservation near the Harrison River, heard his dogs barking and came face to face with a hairy giant that was nude, covered with a fluff of black hair from head to foot, except for around the eyes. After one look, Frank ran into the house and locked the door as the wild man strode leisurely into the bush. The creature was tall, muscular, and had a ferocious aspect. This was at Morris Creek, which is a small tributary of the Harrison River in British Columbia. There were several reports of the same creature. Mr. Frank Dan, an American First Nation, was canoeing in Morris Creek off the Harrison River in British Columbia, Canada, when a hairy humanoid appeared on the side of a mountain and started throwing rocks at him. Sometimes you just get them in a bad mood. Mr. Dan had seen wild men previously. On to the next one. Near Brideville in British Columbia in Canada, Mrs. Jane Patterson saw a Bigfoot sitting in an abandoned garden. On to the next one. Miss Jeannie Chapman and her daughter Rosie saw an 8-foot-tall hairy humanoid emerge from the woods and approach their farmhouse on Ruby Creek beside the Fraser River in Caribou County in British Columbia. Miss Chapman grabbed her 3 children, aged 9, 7, and 5, and fled for the woods. Her eldest son had thought that he had seen a cow coming out of the woods, and she thought it was a bear until it got closer. It was a huge, hairy man, about 7.5 feet tall, wide-shouldered and with long arms. The creature was covered in pale yellow-brown hair that was about 4 inches long. On her return, she found that a heavy barrel of salted fish had been overturned and its contents scattered. gigantic footprints encircled the house that were 16 inches long by 8 inches wide with a step of 4 foot. The creature visited the cabin every night for a week afterward. This was too much for the Chapmans, who fled the house and never returned. Who knows what lurks in the woods? On to the next one. In October of 1941, many of the local First Nations fled in their canoes after seeing a 14-foot-tall Bigfoot in their village near Port Douglas at the head of Harrison Lake in British Columbia. On to the next one. At Harrison Mills, at the bottom of Harrison Lake in Westminster County in British Columbia, Henry Charlie was picking berries when he saw a 6-foot-tall hairy wild man that grunted and hit Henry to the ground, hitting Henry on the arm and leg and breaking his arm. There were other witnesses, including Henry's wife, and it was definitely not a bear. The attack happened 1 mile from Katz, and the hairy humanoid chased Harry for more than a mile. On to the next one. Mr. and Mrs. Werner were on a jeep on a logging road on Grouse Mountain near Vancouver in British Columbia when they saw two creatures that were naked but not quite human, wearing skins wrapped around them. The two creatures had bare feet and long shoulder-length hair. It becomes weirder when the taller creature was described as carrying a stick with a kind of bag attached to it and appeared to be leading the smaller creature, whose hands appeared tied together. The creature's feet were huge, and the bigger of the two was 8 feet tall, while the smaller one was a mere 6 feet tall. The faces were flat, with wide noses, small eyebrows, and bushy eyebrows. On to the next one. In Carroll County in Tennessee, it was late fall, shortly after sundown. My girlfriend and I went for a walk down the road that ran in front of her house. The weather was cool and the sky was clear. We walked with the shoulder of the road to our right. Slightly off the road, there was a fence row about 6 feet above the level of the road. As we were walking along the road, I heard something tramping around on the fence row. We got spooked. The noise continued. I just had to know what it was, so I jumped up on the fence row and looked across a cut cornfield. As I looked across the field, I noticed something walking along a ditch. It appeared to be tall and slender, with shaggy brown skin. I hollered at it, and it stepped off into a ditch bank. We got scared and ran back to my girlfriend's house. The next day, I went back and searched through the cornfield. I found several large footprints in some leftover lime. They were slightly larger than my size 12 shoe and appeared to be barefoot human, except much bigger. A few weeks later, my girlfriend and I were walking around a pond near an old home place. We heard something walking through the woods. It didn't sound like a deer or a man. It sounded different. We stayed a few minutes listening to this something walking through the woods. Feeling kinda on edge, we left. Over the next few weeks, I kept an eye out for anything unusual, but didn't find anything. The first sighting was an early evening after the sun had set, twilight. The area was open farmland with fence rows and a small stand of trees. Cluttered southern forest. There had been several other sightings in the area for years. There was one sighting in the winter during the early 70s. A man in Christmasville found footprints in the snow around his house and farm. On to the next one. This was near Englewood in McMinn County in Tennessee. I grew up in a very rural area of Tennessee. My grandparents had a farm that lies on the border of Monroe and McMinn counties. I was playing in the garage, which is downhill from the house. Across the road was a wooded area. As I was playing, I felt like someone was staring at me. I looked up to find what I first thought was a very hairy man looking at me until I realized it didn't have any clothes on. I became very frightened and dropped to the ground between cars and rolled up underneath the car. The creature was dark brown to black in color. It was about 7 feet tall, as best that I can guess. Its facial features were similar to a human's. I'm pretty sure that it saw me. I hid as soon as I saw it because it scared me quite badly. I lay there for approximately 15 minutes. After a while, I heard men talking and crawled out from underneath the car. I ran into the house and stayed there for the rest of the day. When I went into the house, my mother asked me what was wrong, as I looked like I had seen a ghost. At the time, this area was thickly wooded. The woods were soon cut down. There are still wooded breaks between fields. It was around 2 or 3 in the afternoon. The time of year was around fall to early winter, as I can remember wearing a coat. Several of my relatives still live in that area. On to the next one. In Shelby County in Tennessee, there were 6 of us driving towards Shelby Forest one night just after dark. We had probably driven 5 or 6 miles from Highway 51 when I saw something run across the road in front of the car, just inside of the headlights range. At the same time I saw this, the driver of the car stopped immediately and looked around at everyone in the car. Apparently, he could tell by my look I saw it too, and then asked me directly if I saw it. I said yes, and then we drove in reverse until there was a turnaround between the divided highway and got out of there. To this day, I'm not sure what it was, but it was on 2 feet and was very fast. Watkins Extended is divided, and it crossed 4 traffic lanes and the median in just a couple of seconds. It was very big and black and looked like it was covered with fur. It was hard to tell exactly since it was just inside the headlight range and happened very quickly. It ran with a slight forward tilt and with very little arm bend. No one else in the car saw it besides myself and the driver. It was night, just after dark, in open fields surrounded by river bottoms and forest. On to the next one. In Big Ridge State Park, near Norris, in Anderson County, in Tennessee, I was coming back from fishing at Big Ridge State Park with my mom, dad, and small son. We were walking along a trail that led from the lake we were fishing at to the parking lot through the woods. My son and I were in front of my mom and dad, and I had turned my head around to tell them something when I turned back around. There it was. It was about 20 to 25 feet in front of my son and I. It looked to be about 8 to 9 feet tall. I didn't see a neck on it, and it looked straight ahead of it. It swung its arms when it walked, and its strides were 4 to 6 feet long. The trail itself was about 4 to 5 feet across. It was walking at about 5 miles per hour. It was black with some brown mixed in. It walked very swiftly, and the terrain it went on after walking in front of us was flat but thick with bushes and trees, and I couldn't see it anymore. I gasped and turned around real fast and told my mom and dad that I had just seen Bigfoot. We did not go look for tracks because it was just getting dark, and we kept walking. We didn't hear any sounds after the encounter. It went so fast, I just got a glimpse. I know it wasn't a human. Me and my young son, we were walking, and I turned to talk, and when I turned around, there it was. It was at dusk. I've heard of people finding footprints in or around that area, but none quite like mine. On to the next one. The following are a collection of wild man accounts from the turn of the century that share a remarkable resemblance to modern-day Bigfoot and Sasquatch encounters. Bosco, the wild man of the University of Washington campus, is on the job again, according to reports turned in to the police by two women of the university district who claim they were chased by a man dressed like September Morn on the campus last night. One of the women, whose names the police refused to make public, fell and was injured during the chase. Bosco the Bushman, who terrorized the residents in the university district a month ago, is again at work. This time, he is near Medina. T.W. Flynn telephoned Under Sheriff McCormick today that the wild man was yelling in a dense thicket and seeking the blood of all who dared pass that spot. Citizens fear to tackle Bosco. He has a habit of biting trees in two. He ate a dog and hurled a heavy boulder at an Italian laborer recently. Deputy Sheriff Sullivan and Smith, fully armed, started for Medina at noon and will try to subdue and capture Bosco. With opening day of the winter term at the university approaching, faculty and regents are making every effort to capture or chase away the mysterious wild man, who for nearly a year now has been terrifying female students by attacking them on lonely parts of the campus. Not only did he appear at numerous times throughout the last winter, but he has lurked around the campus all summer, and only a week ago, he nearly frightened the life out of a young woman on the university grounds. Every strategy that could be thought of has been employed to capture him. Both faculty and male students under the direction of Bursar Herbert T. Condon have patrolled the campus hours at all times after night, but the man sneaks away when the men are around. He is bold, though, in the presence of women, attacking groups of two and even three when he finds them alone and unguarded. Indignant male students will make it one of their season's activities this year to capture the wild man, just as Dobie's men make it a point to corral the football championship. And if they do capture him, tragedy threatens to be writ in the annals of the institution. Sheriff Hodge and Deputy Elliot and Bush beat about the woods in the vicinity of O'Brien Sunday without being able to locate a wild man who has been reported in that section. The wild man has appeared again at the university campus. Whether it is the same man who last year terrorized the women of the student body or a new recruit, he is emphatically there, and as a result of his attempting to attack several girls on the campus at night, Dean of Women Caldwell has advised all university women to not appear on campus or secluded streets after 5 p.m. except in groups of three or more. The wild man has made his presence felt in such an extent last year that a student patrol was organized in an attempt to capture him, but he attacked only when he was sure no help was near. The students refer to him as Bosco. In the spring, two suspects were captured and lodged in jail. The wild man has been haunting the campus for a number of years. 2 years ago, several members of the SAE fraternity captured a fellow. On to the next one. Answering a call from several citizens of Spanway, Sheriff Longmire, accompanied by deputies Stenso and Frank Longmire, left early today with the bloodhound Torger in search for a wild man reported to have been terrorizing the countryside for 2 weeks. The mysterious man is said to be of a short, dark-complexioned person. He runs like a deer and lives in the woods. He has been seen on several occasions at Roy McKenna, Spanway, and other prairie towns. He has frightened several young girls and women, and the communities are so stirred up that many persons are living in continual fear. A large delegation of farmers aided in the hunt. The wild man will appear suddenly in the open, and after making insane motions, he will dart off into the woods and disappear, say those who have seen him. He never appears twice in the same place. One night he will be reported at Banway, and the next he will bob up at Yelm. He is described as being a short man. He wears a black suit and occasionally goes without a hat. Men living in the district have been unable to get within a hangnail's distance as he immediately turns and runs. Children living near Vogel Ranch, about 1¾ miles northeast of Spanway, say they saw the man looking around a tree at them last night as they were getting water from a well. They screamed, and he disappeared into the darkness. A posse of 20 farmers scoured the woods, but could find no traces. Sheriff Longmire and Torger looked into every vacant house in the district today. County Speed Officer Chilberg will be stationed near Spanway the next few days patrolling the wooded district. On to the next one. A Sub Rosa manhunt is in progress on the university campus to capture an elusive wild man whose after dark pastime has been to terrorize coeds. He has made a sudden appearance Thursday night, stepping from the shadows and letting out a yell when Miss Gertrude Elliott, in charge of the campus commons, and two girl students were passing the home economics building. They could not see his face, but they noticed he was only partly dressed. Because students and authorities of the university have been trying to catch the fellow for more than a year, the young women plan to summon aid. When Miss Elliott and one of her friends stepped behind two trees, the third girl ran for Night Officer Bloom, who patrols the campus. But the so-called wild man suddenly turned and ran before the posse of Officer Bloom and his three feminine assistants could get a start. The story of the wild man seen Thursday night, however, is only the latest of a long series of alarming appearances of the strange acting man, or men, as the case may be. Of 4 years, there have been intermittent campaigns to catch him. Every few weeks, some girl or groups of girls have been frightened. A year ago, all the men of the university were called to gather at an assembly where the situation was discussed by Dean Priest and Comptroller Condon. The men students were told what was going on and asked to suggest some way of capturing the wild man. No practical method was evolved. The women held assemblies. Rules were passed that no co-ed should go on the campus alone after dark. There were weeks when the fellow would not be seen. Then he would bob up again, appearing suddenly from the thick underbrush lining the campus walkway. Finally, much of the brush was cut out. One night in February 1916, he followed a young woman from one of the streets outside of the campus over the path that leads to the girls' dormitory. She permitted him to get close to her, suddenly turning and struck him in the face with her suitcase. She then ran into the dormitory. At other times, he has hidden in the brush and peeped out when the girls passed by. He often lets out a yell and then goes scurrying away into the dark. C.J. Horton, professional golfer of the University Golf Club, was made a special officer recently and is on the lookout for the wild man. Brief descriptions in the hands of authorities at the university indicate that the fellow is thin and tall. He often wears a cap and is believed to be comparatively young. Some think he is the same man who has been seen near the Green Lake School and at some of the playgrounds. On to the next one. An insane woman running wildly through the woods near the sanitarium at Riverton was reported Monday morning to be alarming residents of the Riverton district. According to the report, she has been living several days on blackberries and runs away frightened when approached by the residents. Deputies were sent out Monday morning to search the woods. I hope you enjoyed those encounters. And if you did, be sure to hit that like button, leave a comment, and subscribe. I post new content every single day, so be sure to hit that notification bell, and you'll be notified exactly when that new content arrives on my channel. Again, thank you so much, and until next time, bye!